thing to be doing here. I mean, this dome is incredible, and you all look really amazing, and it's just so fun to be up here and talking. So I wrote a book that was called Breaking Open the Head, and the book is both like personal and kind of philosophical, and it sort of charts my shift. When I started as a kind of secular materialist journalist, and got interested in studying psychedelic drugs when I was in my late 20s, and shamanism, and went to a bunch of indigenous cultures to explore their rituals. I went down to Gabon in West Africa and was initiated into the Bwiti tribe, taking iboga, and I visited the Sequoia Indians in Ecuador, taking ayahuasca, and the Mazatecs I visited in Mexico and Oaxaca, and also explored, you know, more sort of non-ritualistic, hedonistic use of psychedelics. And the whole experience was an incredible opening for me, opening me to all of this sort of new information, for, you know, visionary experiences, and it really completely changed my perspective on reality over time. And I ended up, you know, sort of converting from the materialist perspective that I'd started from to a you know, kind of thinking that the shamanic vision of reality was absolutely more accurate than the Western materialist view. And you know, that was a very profound shift, and it was also kind of a frightening thing to contemplate, because, you know, our society is so invested in industrialization and materialism. You know, it just seemed that suddenly this huge aspect of reality, which was the whole kind of intuitive, magical domain, had just been negated by our system. So I just really had to mull on that for a long time. And that kind of led me to start working on the second book, which is called 2012, The Return of Quetzalcoatl, which is hopefully coming out, well, it's definitely going to come out in the spring, April or May. Basically, I started to take seriously, it's like if I converted to this shamanic perspective, then I sort of had to take seriously what all these cultures said about what's happening in the world now and what's going to happen. And I especially got interested in the Hopi prophecies and the material on the Mayan calendar. And you know, part of the whole process for me was like this kind of personal process where, as I got deeper into exploring all of this stuff, I had to learn also to take synchronicities that occurred in my own life increasingly seriously, and just become, you know, more and more tuned to sort of patterns that emerged over time. And so, for instance, one thing that happened to me is I'd edited a book that a friend of mine wrote. It was a book-length poem about ranting against corporate globalization and the oil companies, and also talking about using ayahuasca, and also talking about 2012 in the Mayan calendar. How many people know 2012 or have read about it a bit? So some of you haven't. So basically, the first person to kind of explore it was José Arguelles, but the Mayans were a culture that was really obsessed with time, and they had these incredible calendars that were sort of like synchronometers, kind of following the movements of the planets, and just measuring huge cycles of time. Gosh, is there no way we can let a few more people in? I just feel so sad to see all those like faces out there. Okay. Anyway. Yeah. You want to come sit on the podium? That's great. Are you? I don't know. What's that? Oh yeah. Come in from the side. That's a great idea. Come in from the side. You can sit up on the podium. I like that. Yeah. There's stairs in the back. Yeah. A lot. Looks pretty strong to me. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so anyway, I looked at this, and I'll get back to the Mayan stuff. But basically, a lot of their cosmology seems to point to this end date in 2012, December 21st, 2012, as being this incredibly significant moment. And they really memorialized it in their stone structures, and kind of pointed towards it and alluded to it in a lot of different ways and different levels. So so I was editing Michael's book, so we talked about 2012, and for him, his thing was that, oh, you know, we're headed for this total industrial apocalypse, and sort of envisioning, you know, what would happen when the oil ran out and the whole thing went to shit. And I sort of put off editing the book, because I didn't really want to deal with it, and I was in my house in downtown Manhattan, and finally I was like, all right, I've got to work on Michael's book. And it was in the morning, you know, I opened the book, finally started, you know, thinking about it and making line notes, and after about 15 minutes, there was this weird thud outside of the window, and we opened the blinds, and there were the World Trade Towers burning down, and the book was already titled World on Fire. So that, for me, was one of many like really significant kind of synchronicities that just led me to feel that whatever investigation I was making was somehow a really important one, and that there was you know, something to this whole Mayan calendar stuff. And so basically, I'd started to think about, you know, this whole shamanic reality and wondering how there might be, if it was legitimate, I thought there had to be more manifestations of it in the real world. And kind of almost out of giving up, I mean, I also got very into, after editing Michael's book, worried about the whole you know, the sort of collapse of the ecological systems and the sense that we are headed for this incredible breakdown point. Through the global climate change and the depletion of the oil and so on. So in the midst of my kind of despair over all this stuff, I started looking into the crop circles, which I'd always kind of assumed were a hoax. But, you know, when I began to look at them, I realized that they developed into this huge phenomenon that had become incredibly complex. And the glyphs themselves were just amazingly beautiful and extraordinary. And I got an assignment from Wired magazine to write about the crop circles. So I had an opportunity to talk to all these people who've been researching them for years, you know, people who completely debunked them, scientists who had also been studying them and had done work on like how the plants were affected in the formations. And the one guy I talked to who I kind of enjoyed the most was this guy, Michael Glickman, who was a former architect who moved to England and retired and spent 10 years just studying the crop circles. And when I talked to him, you know, he was like, look, this is what I think is going on with these things. You know, he ran down a little bit why he didn't think they could possibly be hoaxes, which I can explain in more detail if you want. And then he said that he felt that they were indicating a dimensional shift, and that this shift was going to culminate in 2012. And that some of the crop circles had been synchronized, had shown, you know, dates relative to the Mayan calendar, including one that had appeared in the late 90s, which was a grid that had the number of squares in the grid were exactly the number of weeks from that point until the end of 2012. So he gave me, I mean, then I went to England, to Glastonbury, he gave a conference, and I heard him give this talk where he really went into his kind of signs of the dimensional shift, which I've kind of kept thinking about and just kind of elaborating on over time. And what he felt were some of the signs of what's going on is the experience, the sense of time speeding up, that it seems that more and more events are happening in a shorter and shorter amount of linear time. There's this kind of compaction taking place. And he talked about how it seemed that there was increasingly kind of a sort of intensification of the psychic nature of reality, through things like synchronicities, through events that would sort of violate Newtonian Cartesian kind of principles, just little light events, almost humorous events that would happen. I mean, he showed these photographs of sheep forming this like perfect circle in Scotland, and stuff like that. He also talked about, he felt that the karmic rubber band was snapping back faster and faster, so it was kind of like rewards and punishments were being meted out at higher and higher speeds, you know, so it was like you could no longer cover up anything. You can no longer escape from the consequences of your actions, which to me was very interesting because if you think of the word apocalypse, which I would also say, you know, if this hypothesis is correct, this time would be the apocalypse, that word literally means uncovering or revealing. And there is a sense that nothing can be hidden anymore. You know, I mean, you know, we can see Clinton, George W. Jr. and Sr., you know, all praying together at the body of the dead Pope, you know. I mean, you know, we can just see the sort of ridiculous overt manifestations of the kind of corruption of the whole system just so self-evidently now. It's, you know, they don't even try to hide the conspiracy and the cynicism anymore. You know, the way I began to think about it was that in a sense it feels that material reality itself is somehow becoming increasingly psychically responsive and slightly less materially dense. How many people feel that those kind of resonate with their experience, just as a, And another aspect of it, which I think is really crucial, is the sort of integration of scientific knowledge and kind of esoteric or shamanic wisdom traditions. So that, I mean, and this has been like an undercurrent since the 70s with, you know, Kapler's book, The Tao of Physics. But that really, like, you know, and this movie, What the Bleep Do We Know, was another kind of step in that direction. But really, the science can be seen as really supporting a kind of mystical or esoteric vision of reality. And it can just be elaborated in deeper and deeper ways. There's one physicist called Amit Goswami, this Indian physicist, who's interviewed in What the Bleep Do We Know. And, you know, he's really looking at how quantum physics provides kind of like a roadmap for thinking about, you know, reincarnation, like how an individual could reincarnate through kind of like a quantum memory. So it just seems like we're, you know, on firmer and firmer ground when we, you know, want to stake our claim that there is a kind of spiritual or metaphysical reality. And then also, as we were talking about the other day, Rick Straussman's work with DMT, dimethyltryptamine, which he believed was the spirit molecule. He looked at the fact that, according to the Buddhists, the soul reincarnates 7 weeks after death, and the pineal gland is formed in fetal development 49 days after conception, and that's where DMT is produced. And so he did this whole study on DMT, where, you know, if you take DMT, you're shot at this completely alternative dimension, kind of higher dimension of reality. And his thesis is that DMT is this kind of conductive medium that brings the soul into the body. And also at death, like a flood of DMT is released, which causes, you know, the life review and the sort of near-death experiences that people talk about. So, I mean, there's just a lot of stuff like that. There's this increasing ability to kind of elaborate and establish at least good hypotheses of how science can be integrated with this kind of shamanic perception of reality. So, let's see. So, yeah, so I got more and more involved in studying the crop circles. You know, it really seems to me at this point that it's the most extraordinary anomalous event that's happening on an incredibly large scale that people are just mostly not capable of paying attention to. And in that sense, it's very much like psychedelics, which, you know, the mainstream culture just totally ignores, or the Times will still call them like toys of the hippie generation. So there's this kind of willful repression or suppression of something that is so super interesting and important. And especially this summer, the crop circles, and I suggest if you want to check it out, there's a website called cropcircleconnector.com, and you can see all the crop circles from this last summer, and a lot of them are very specifically Mayan-related, using Mayan imagery, and people have been sort of decoding, there seems to be encoded information about certain dates and times, and they're relating to the next few years. And basically, just briefly, this biophysicists have done studies of the plants and the formations and have published papers in peer-reviewed science journals that the plants, the way they were affected would have to be caused by single-point sources of electromagnetic radiation coming from above, because they kind of, they do this kind of heliotropism, and they find these kind of, they create these kind of strange bulbs and other stuff. They've done all this documentation of how they grow after they're affected. And also the hoaxers, the ones who claim to be making the formations, really are not capable of making ones as pristine and precise and amazing as the ones that are unclaimed, for the most part. I mean, there are obviously hoaxing going on, and there are man-made ones, but I think a very significant proportion of them really have no likely cause in human action, as far as we know it. And the whole phenomenon goes on every year, mainly in England. There's about 70 or 80 of them in England each year, and they're just incredibly complex and beautiful. And they seem to be indicating a lot of kind of pieces of the puzzle. And part of it is this kind of integration of science and esoteric wisdom. They'll use like fractals that are based on, you know, esoteric symbols, like the Star of David turned into the Koch fractal, where you kind of elaborate on the triangles. And I actually went to England. And the other thing that became clear to me as I studied the phenomenon, I spent a whole summer in Glastonbury rushing around, like whenever we heard of a new one, we would go that morning and look at it and talk to the farmer whose land it was on and, you know, all the people who were involved with the whole thing, you know, including some people who claimed to be hoaxing. It became clear to me that indeterminacy was part of the nature of the phenomenon, and that actually the phenomenon was very much about conscious intention. Because after a while I began to see that everybody who came to be involved with this phenomenon, how they sort of, what they came in with their set and setting of ideas about it, really structured what they would find. So if they were skeptical and cynical about it, they would find all this evidence that suggested they were human-made. And they would sort of just go for that evidence. If they were kind of new age bliss bunnies, they would feel like their light bodies were activated, they would see UFOs and angels and stuff like that. But if you had like a kind of skeptical and open perspective on it, you know, or just an open perspective, you would sort of take in all these different levels of information until your sort of whole rational structure just collapsed. So it almost seemed like there was no single cause for some of the formations. And for me, I was like sitting up with it like night after night, you know, unable to sleep after a while, just trying to puzzle out what this thing meant, and was it real, was it a joke, you know. And finally I got it, that it was very much about indeterminacy and about paradox and learning how to work with paradox, because we live in a very dualistic culture where we always want to go to one side or the other side. We're very quick to want to close off the paradox or feel there's some kind of ultimate solution. And it seemed to me that part of what the crop circles were telling us was to embrace paradox, and to actually, when you find the paradox, to go deeper in rather than seeking to resolve it in some sort of simplified way. So it was definitely like a deep teaching, I mean, just exploring the whole phenomenon. And also the other thing that became clear to me is that if they are, which I think they are, manifestations of other levels of galactic intelligence, and probably the star nations that all the indigenous, you know, cultures know about, what they're telling us is that when you get to that higher level of consciousness, you're not, you know, I mean, I talked to this guy from SETI, the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. He was like, oh, the crop circles are rubbish. You know, if there were any higher civilization that wanted to communicate with us, they would just leave Encyclopedia Galactica on our doorstep with all the cool technology and stuff. And I was, and after a while, I realized that actually if you reach the higher level of intelligence, you might be more interested in play and, art. You know, you might be more interested in subtlety and nuance rather than just some technical manual of spaceflight, you know. So I think that's what they're telling us. It's like that we have to bring our full toolkit to the table, you know, if we want to reach that sort of level. So for my book, I then began to look at a whole bunch of different kind of models or matrices or philosophical idea systems to think about what this dimensional shift means and how we could kind of conceptualize it and sort of bring it down to earth so we can kind of hold it and integrate it with our own lives and our own perspective and what that kind of means. And one way, as I mentioned, was this notion of apocalypse. And I read some really great Jungian books by the disciple of Jung, Edinger. One is called Archetypes of the Apocalypse. And he really sees the apocalypse as an event in the psyche. He thinks that it's the it represents the coming, the self-realization of human consciousness, where you integrate all of the kind of shadow material, you know, the dark and the light, so you don't have to project it anymore. But at first you have to go through that projection situation, which is what we seem to be doing right now. You know, on a global scale, we're just constantly projecting our shadow deeper and deeper into the material world and into socio-political conflicts and so on. So we're not able to really reconcile our situation. So part of the apocalypse would be, you know, this revealing process. And if you look at the Book of Revelation, in a way, it's really like a tantric text. There are all these, really intense imagery, like the angels who are dropping these kind of you know, vials of wrath are doing it from golden bowls, you know, and the whore of Babylon drinks the disgusting filth of her fornication from a golden cup, which symbolizes kind of the vessel of the higher self. So it's sort of, it seems to be pointing out that you have to just work with all levels of the psyche and all levels of the shadow material and really do the work to integrate that. So then also I got really interested in the whole idea of the Kali Yuga, which is from Hinduism. And according to Hinduism, there are four ages. There's a golden age, silver age, a bronze age, and an iron age. And each one is progressively shorter and faster and sort of darker than the previous one. And they say that we're in the Kali Yuga, which is the age of materialism and kind of destruction. And Kali is the goddess of sort of destruction. She's the sort of wrathful entity who's dancing on a corpse, and she liberates through decapitating. And then I also got interested in the idea that Kali is also the wrathful manifestation of the goddess Shakti, which is the, you know, sort of deity of energy, especially sexual energy, in any form of manifestation. And her consort is Shiva, who represents kind of universal consciousness, which is like the masculine principle. And it's their union which kind of holds reality together. It's in the book. I mean, it's lengthy to explain, but it seems to me like that the Kali energy that's really part of our culture has to be deeply kind of interrogated and understood. And one way to think about it is if you think about archetypes, you know, when we have this notion of that our culture is materialistic, and the word materialism, the root of that word is mater, which means mother, you know, but it's like we've taken the sort of negative side of the mother archetype. So, you know, instead of, you know, nurturing, it's kind of aggrieved, possessive, enraged. And so we've created these systems, we've inherited these systems of kind of false nurturing, artificial nurturing, which are trying to constantly fill the void that's lacking because people didn't get this actual nurturing. So you have like fast food or sugar and starch substitutes. You know, in every way, it's the culture's kind of shorting out gratification. And so I think that the sort of understanding this kind of Kali energy is really, really important, and how it manifests in personal lives and personal relationships, and really trying to kind of bring Shakti back into balance. You know, is really intense work that you know, everybody here is involved with, whether they know it or not. So then also I got interested in the Hopis, who talk about the this period being the transition from one world to another. They say that this is the fourth world, and that we're moving into the fifth world, and there have been three previous worlds. I mean, it's more complicated than that, because in a sense for them, all time is happening at the same time. They just have a different vision of time than we do, which is embedded in their language in a way. And the Mayans and the Aztecs similarly talked about this being the age of the fifth sun transitioning to the sixth sun. And the Aztecs, who kind of inherited the Mayan culture but kind of debased and degraded it, were doing huge amounts of human sacrifice at the end of their empire, I think as much as like 50 or 70,000 people a year. And they were doing this in order to keep the sun alive. They felt that if they didn't do all the sacrifice, the sun would simply go out, and then they'd enter this transition period into the sixth sun. So then I also got very, starting from my first book, I got very involved in the ideas of Rudolf Steiner, who was an Austrian clairvoyant and visionary philosopher, who is just absolutely extraordinary and I think very, very important. I really feel that his ideas are going to be like as important for our time as Nietzsche's were for the 20th century, really giving us a different foundation and just an approach to reality on so many levels. But Steiner also basically said that he realized that the mission of his life on Earth was to bring the knowledge of reincarnation back to the West, and this knowledge had been lost since the beginning of Christianity, and that just as Tibetan Buddhists talk about, you know, where they recognize these lamas who keep coming back in life after life, that had also been going on in the West, because we'd lost the knowledge and the understanding that it had been happening without, you know, people recognizing it. So he did these books called Karmic Relationships, where he would track particular Western individualities back through a whole series of lives. Steiner also said that not only do human beings reincarnate again and again, but the Earth itself reincarnates, and that this is the fourth incarnation of the Earth. That was his theme song, in fact, actually. That this is the fourth incarnation of the Earth, moving towards the fifth incarnation. And he was very interesting that he actually elaborated some of the ways he thought the sort of physical organism and the spiritual organism would shift as we moved into this next incarnation of the Earth. I mean, there's a lot of stuff about Steiner which is just totally amazing. I mean, one thing that relates to this mind thing for me is that he really conceived of, you know, the planets as not just being like hunks of matter kind of rolling around out there. They were more like kind of vibrational matrices or kind of other modalities of consciousness that were in a kind of harmonic relationship to the Earth, you know. So, this is very alchemical. Like the alchemists talk about Mars representing certain forces and energies and Venus representing certain forces and energies. And in terms of the Mayan calendar stuff, there's a lot about Venus and some about Mars that are significant. These two big Venus transits, one was in 2004, another I think it's right around 2012, that are kind of representing this kind of, you know, complex rebalancing of male and female energies, which I think is one of the key things that is sort of going on right now on the planet, and also one thing that everybody is sort of having to deal with and struggle with in their own personal lives. When I read that, I mean, it may sound kind of hokey at first, but then if you look at, like, the relationship, for instance, between, like, the Earth and the Venus, their orbital relationships are incredibly harmonic. I don't think I'm going to remember this right now, but there's basically these incredible phi-based relationships between the Earth and Venus. And I think one Venus turns very, very slowly on its axis, so that one day on Venus is exactly two-thirds of an Earth year. And the way Venus approaches the Earth, when it's at its closest point, it always turns this same face to us, and it's in this perfect, like, phi-based relationship. And that's why for the ancients, Venus was the planet of beauty, because it had this incredible harmonic relationship to the Earth. I also studied this philosopher, Jean Gebser, who was a German philosopher who published a huge book in the 50s. It was his life's work called The Ever-Present Origin. And he also was very interested, I mean, for him, he saw it as, the evolution of human consciousness in terms of shifts or mutations into different consciousness structures. And that there had been several previous ones in the past, which he called the archaic and the magic, the mythical, and then what we were in now was the mental rational consciousness structure, which had kind of subdivided reality in a very certain way, and created a kind of linear model of time, which didn't really exist before. I mean, history is a kind of modern conception. You know, like the mythical civilizations had no conception of history as we conceive of it. They were conceiving of cycles, you know, or kind of spirals, you know. So Gebser theorized that there was going to be a movement at a kind of crisis of anxiety. There would be a movement from this mental rational consciousness structure into what he called the integral or aperspectival consciousness, which would be a different form of consciousness that kind of had a different relationship to time. Just to elaborate on that a little bit, he talked about how these previous forms, when they arose, each one kind of negated the one before. So the archaic or aboriginal form of time is like every day is the first day. I mean, there's a really good book by the aboriginals called Voices of the First Day. And their whole thing was that you do rituals to just preserve reality in its perfect manifestation. They never thought there was a fall or a decline, you know, into an impure state. And then the magical cultures had this kind of instant, like magic happens like instantaneously, you know. That was sort of their time. And then the mythical cultures sort of elaborated these huge cyclical times. So the Hindus have these yugas, which last hundreds of thousands of years. The Mayans had these great cycles that were 5,000 years and more. The Egyptians had the precession of the equinox, which was a 26,000-year cycle, also linked to astronomical events. So that's their way of looking at it. And then we have this linear kind of spatialized model of time. Gebser's idea is that we became obsessed with matter and space in a way that nobody had been obsessed with it previously. And that we began to think that we could spatialize and materialize everything. So when we looked at time, we quantified and spatialized time in a way. So the whole way we think of time is that we think of there being, you know, amounts of time, you know, time runs out, you know, you don't have enough time, you're wasting time, you're spending time. We're constantly thinking of time as this quantity that somehow you can have enough of or not have enough of, or actually you can basically never have enough of it from this perspective. But that, for him, is a wrong way of looking at time. That's imposing this kind of three-dimensional model of space onto non-dimensional or multi-dimensional reality of time. So this integral perspective would be an integration of all these previous relationships to time. You would know every minute, the same minute, that you were in that archaic reality where you were always at the first day, always at the creation point. You would also be in that magical, sort of instantaneous manifestation time, and you would also be in this mythical cyclical time, and you would also be in the mental, rational, linear time. And he's so talked about these as being kind of veils that you would be able to look through. And to me, that feels, you know, very sort of copacetic with the Burning Man experience, which is this kind of manifestation of this archaic revival. And you know, trying to get sort of back into contact with this kind of primordial forces, and learning how to be more present again, and not have this kind of insane time complex which dominates modern civilization, and this kind of this flaw in our conception of time is kind of embodied in our technologies, and also in our calendar, in very serious ways. So that was Gebser's perspective. So basically, yeah, so I've been trying to integrate all these different models of what this dimensional shift is like, you know, why we're going through it. And, you know, it's not like I know the, you know, exact endpoints, but I think there's very significant information coming through about the Mayan calendar material. This was first going to be elaborated by Jose Arguelles, who wrote a book called The Mayan Factor, and a more recent book called Time in the Technosphere. I mean, a lot of people here probably know about, how many people here know about Terence McKenna and the time wave zero? Yeah. So basically, McKenna, when he was a kid in the early 70s, went down to the Amazon and took huge amounts of mushrooms with his brother. And basically, his brother had a sort of schizophrenic break, and McKenna became in communication with the mushroom intelligence and began to get this continual download from the mushroom intelligence. And the mushroom explained to him that the mushroom was a galactic intelligence that disseminated itself through the universe on spores that would be sent on meteorites. They would crash into planets, then wherever you know, mammals developed, the kind of central nervous system developed, it would create a symbiotic relationship with mammalian species as it evolved into intelligence. And the mushroom said that we were on the verge of making a fully conscious kind of symbiotic relationship with the mushroom intelligence that would lead us into the sort of mainstream echelons of advanced galactic civilizations. And it also gave him information about time, which was this whole vision of this kind of fractal or hyperdimensional time linked to the evolution of consciousness, so which he tried to sort of quantify in this time wave zero in terms of the acceleration of novelty and technology. Leading to, and then when he went home and spent months and months working on it, and he had sort of software, you know, he correlated it to the same date in December 2012 that the Mayans used, but he didn't know the Mayans had done this until later. That's what he said. And so Arguelles was somebody who went into studying this whole Mayan cosmology, because the archaeologists just say, oh, you know, they were just really into time because, you know, it was a way to make themselves, the kings, feel good, you know, because the kings could then say, oh, I'm connected to these events that were way in the past, you know. But Arguelles actually looked at their use of time and their obsession with vast cycles of time, even like hundreds of millions or billions of years. And he felt that they were indicating that we're in this final cycle that had started around 3,100 BC and culminated in 2012. It was like a 5,100-year cycle that was moving us through linear history at this increasingly accelerated rate till we would enter into this higher level galactic sort of framework. So then these other people have come along and elaborated his ideas, one being John Major Jenkins, wrote a book called Galactic Alignments, and really looked carefully at how different Mayan sites use this material and information And then I think really amazing and fascinating is this guy, Carl Johan Kallman, who was a Swedish biologist and cancer specialist who worked for the World Health Organization. And he has written a book called The Mayan Calendar and the Transformation of Consciousness, where basically he began to study this stuff, sort of taking Arguelles' ideas and elaborating on them, and then looked at the fact that the major Mayan pyramids, and there are three major cities, were all these nine-stage pyramids. And he ended up coming with this model that he thinks those pyramids indicate the evolution of consciousness on a nine-stage process, each one 20 times faster in linear time, going all the way back to the Big Bang 16 billion years ago and culminating in 2012. And each stage, you know, it's a very amazing formulation. And I think very, very convincing. And it gets incredibly specific, because these cycles, each one has kind of alternating energy, alternating sort of energy currents, where they're kind of light and dark energies that are related to certain Mayan gods. So for instance, there was a last cycle, which was a 256-year cycle, which started around 1755. Which seemed to be connected to the Industrial Revolution and the movement into, you know, understanding how to work with power and material transformation. And the sort of positive energy current in that cycle culminated around between 1913 to 1931 or 32, which was, you know, the time when Einstein's theories were being disseminated, when Cubism and Modernism and Dadaism were being disseminated, you know, James Joyce and so on. And then the sort of negative energy culminated in the next phase, which was 1931 to 1951, roughly, I think that's about right, which was the Holocaust, Hiroshima, the atom bomb. So that's kind of this model he's working on. It works on all these different stages, even when it gets down to the billion of year stages. And, you know, he's really done a lot of work on elaborating the model. Which means that in terms of the present stage we're in, which started, I think, in 1999, according to his model, 2007, November to November, would be kind of the crystallization of the new form of consciousness that perhaps we're all kind of working towards. And then 2008 would be the kind of destruction of the old form, which for Kallman predicts would be a kind of a global socioeconomic collapse. And to me, that's very, very resonant when you look at a lot of stuff that's going on right now. I mean, a lot of the peak oil predictions have 2008 as a very important year. You know, we can see that this kind of global climate change is really accelerating right now. It's moved into all these accelerating feedback loops. So you have, you know, things happening like what just happened with New Orleans or with the tsunami are becoming more and more frequent events, which are going to, you know, displace huge numbers of people. So we're moving into a much more chaotic system, a chaotic situation, where the socioeconomic structures that have been holding things together are really functioning worse and worse, you know, to the point where they may simply just collapse at a certain point. I mean, Kallman's thesis, which I think I agree with, is that, you know, the positive potential here would be 2008, a kind of collapse of the current socioeconomic structure, and 2009, a kind of recrystallization into a harmonic planetary civilization, abolishing the nation state and this kind of corporate structures, the debt structures that are holding third world countries in slavery. So that's, I think, what we need to work towards. I think there are actually practical tools that will come into play to do that. So let's see. So Arguelles, how many people know about his calendar, the dream spell? He began to realize that this whole time problem was the key, and that somehow our society, that, you know, when we think about what's the deepest underlying problem with our civilization, you know, we think usually it's the patriarchy, or it's technology, or it's, you know, all sorts of things. But like Gebser, he came to the realization that the deepest problem is a missed relationship, or a messed up relationship to time. Now, we'd actually embodied that in our calendar. That if you go back 5,000 years, the cultures that existed pre 3,100 BC roughly were, lunar calendar based, very obsessed with moon cycles, and often great mother worshipping, matriarchal in that sense. And then there was this kind of movement into civilization with agriculture, you know, the building of Stonehenge and the pyramids, and we went from that kind of lunar focus to a solar focus, which was embodied in a solar calendar, where instead of focusing on the actual, you know, real movements of the moon, we took the year, made it into a circle, divided it into 12 parts, and kind of imposed that on reality. So it was like we imposed this abstract grid of time sort of mechanistically onto reality. And by doing that, we desynchronized ourselves from natural cycles. So his idea is that it's kind of like building a building from unsure foundations. The higher the building it gets, the more wobbly it gets, until of necessity it's going to collapse. And that he thought that, you know, because we had desynchronized ourselves from natural cycles, we don't think of the calendar as being very important. We think of it as just, oh, it's just a little thing. But actually, it totally inscribes us in this system. You know, it tells us when we were born, when we pay taxes, when we go to school. You know, so actually, it's locking us into a whole kind of structure of reality. So he began to feel that the only way to combat that would be to go back to this Mayan calendar material. And he began to receive these kind of direct transmissions and channels about how to use the Mayan calendar. And he created this 13-moon system, which was creating this 13-28-day cycle, saying that the moon cycle was essentially 28 days. And, you know, I looked at his system, and I found it really, really interesting, and actually had synchronicities about when I met him and talked to him. You know, I'd been mapped on his calendar. What's that? Okay. 5 minutes, wow. Okay. So he created this alternative calendar. But I began to realize that his calendar is not, I don't think, it's not that it's not correct, it's not that it's not, you can use it, it's a system, but I don't think it's the system. So for him, it's like we have this rush, we have to get his calendar in place before there's this kind of, this global economic collapse. And he's been fighting for that and trying to, you know, present it through the counterculture in the underground and through the UN and every way he can think of. But when I studied the crop circles, it also led me into the stone circles. And I felt like one reason the crop circles are in England, in the region of Avebury and Stonehenge, is they're actually introducing us to what's important about those stone circles. And Stonehenge is actually a temple of solar-lunar integration, which sort of somehow brilliantly, like it's like a computer that puts together lunar eclipses and all this kind of cyclical information. So we have to find a way to do, and it was almost like I think Arguelles became too lunar. He realized that we'd sort of gone into this solar masculine order, and that we had to go back to this lunar intuitive order. But he went too far into the lunar and the intuitive, whereas what we'd actually would need would be once again this kind of really complete integration of a kind of intuitive and rational perspective on time. So what I'm suggesting in my book is that at some point there would have to be a kind of global meeting of minds with scientists, you know, astronomers, physicists, people from different esoteric and indigenous traditions to actually just create a new calendar as a kind of unifying global standard. And what I thought was really brilliant about Arguelles' ideas is that if you had this new calendar, there was a time when there was kind of a socioeconomic collapse, let's say like what might happen in 2008, if you had this tool and through the global commons there became a huge move to implement it, it could instantly delegitimize all of the institutions that are functioning under the old calendar system. So, you know, because they would all, the dates when they had created things would no longer have any relevance. So all of the nation state charters, all of the third world debt structures, the corporate charters, the unfair penal codes. You could just wipe that away. It would be like a kind of collective realization of humanity that we didn't have to be, you know, the inertia of those old systems no longer applied to us, and we could start from a more harmonic basis. And I think, or at least hypothesize, that one reason we've created this kind of global communications system is to act as a kind of a switcher, you know, so when these ideas need to be promulgated at the right time, they can just move very, very quickly around the planet, and we can kind of harmonically move into this different framework. So I guess I can stop there and take some questions. Okay, she's talking about the people who founded the United States had a connection to the astronomical and astrological knowledge. I don't know if it was intentional or not. You know, yeah, I mean, but I agree with you. I mean, it works on every level. I mean, that was the point of Arguelles' book, Time in the Technosphere, that the dating, you know, even in the Gregorian, it all kind of works, that these cycles all are kind of implicated. You know, it's kind of, I see it as just like a single integrated process, an evolutionary process, much like fetal development or something like that, that we're kind of going through on a collective level, you know. Yeah, I think just being, you know, okay. Ugh, tough to repeat these questions. They're long. I don't know. He said something. How can I do this at home? That's what he said. Okay. Yeah, so basically, like, I think, you know, just becoming increasingly aware, trying to completely, you know, increasingly intensify your awareness of synchronicities, of all these things happening, you know, so that you begin to get this awareness, you know, of this, like the Venus transits, you know, how this stuff actually does. Like when I was at Burning Man a few years ago, there was this Mars came really close to the Earth, the closest it had been in 60,000 years. I mean, I felt that that was kind of like perhaps some kind of vibrational shift in the planetary harmonic or something, you know, that, and then just keeping more and more track of your own synchronicities, your own passages, and being more and more present, you know, so you're really in all these different kind of levels of time at the same time, you know. And it's really like, when you really think about it, it's really the neglect of time that has gotten us in a lot of trouble, you know, because the way we approach problems is we do not take time fully into account. So if you think about like the Iraq situation, you know, we're treating Iraq as like, oh, we have to protect Iraq, you know, this nation. Well, colonialism, you know, imperialism created this nation in the 30s. You know, it's a tribal culture. We imposed this nation state on it, and then we act as that as like this permanent thing. You know, I think similar things on all levels, you know, in terms of personal relationships too, you know, that, anyway, this, yeah. I mean, the other thing that I should talk about is I don't think it's about what's actually going to happen on that day. I don't think that's a worthy place to put one's attention. I think what really is important right now is to figure out how to. Who asked the question? Because I can't see. I was trying to look at you. Okay, cool. How do we create the bridging mechanisms to bring into manifestation this more positive reality that we feel could exist and feel very strongly can exist when we come here? And it seems to me, and the one thing I'm working on now is a new magazine and media project, which is called Medicine. And the idea is to disseminate a whole amount of like sort of tools and information to people, even stuff on permaculture, complementary currencies, you know, really, really kind of sustainable uses of, you know, production, you know, producing commodities that don't destroy as you produce them. So yeah, I mean, I'd be happy. I was actually going to just sort of send out this notebook, or people can come up and give me their emails if they want to be included on our email list for this project, which hopefully launch in December. So I think it's really like the key is not to. And that's, I think, one of the problems with Terence McKenna is that he really had people kind of projecting onto this 2012 date that it's like, oh, it's all going to just happen, and we just got to like lay back and wait, and we're involved, we're taking psychedelics, it's amazing. No, it's completely the opposite. The only thing that's going to happen is what we do. You know, we have to take full responsibility, complete responsibility for this situation, and manifest and go absolutely deeper and deeper into the transformational process on a kind of personal and social and professional and societal level. I don't think it's more. It's not. It's more of both. I think that Because, you know, when you begin to really think about it, you know, we've neglected this whole subjective domain of consciousness. You know, Jung talked about the reality of the psyche and how most people were actually not able to really, really conceive that or ground that idea in reality. So I think it's actually what we'll find is that it's both more scientific and more intuitive. Right. Oh, yeah, I meant to talk about that. Yeah. Well, I think that people tend to be very, very scared right now, very, very anxious. I mean, there's this obvious, you know, it's constant kind of ratcheting up of the pressure, you know, this sense like, you know, you feel when you go to an airport, I mean, you know, the TV, the whole thing, it's like this fear vibration is just increasing continuously. And it probably is going to keep increasing. I think one of the really amazing things about right now is how things are getting so much better and so much worse. Constantly. I mean, it is fucking awesome. You know, it is like mind-blowing just to like wrap your mind around that, you know. And I don't see why that's not just going to keep happening, you know. It's just going to keep getting more intense. It's going to get better and it's going to get worse. And the only way to love it is to surrender to the process. You know, none of us are in control of the process. It's like a non-dual integrated situation that you can only attain mastery over. You can't control it, but you can surrender to it. And the deeper you go into the surrender, the deeper you can kind of work with the energy and work on the transformation. So yeah, I think you have to love it. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.